Thank you. Wait.
Your Graces, General Sir John Lady Gibbon, Mr. Mayor, Madam Mayoress, and distinguished guests, welcome to the Royal Arsenal. This ceremony will write another line in the history of the Royal Arsenal, a history which goes back some 300 years, when this site was known as Woolwich Warren. It was purchased by the Crown in 1671 for use as an ordnance storage depot and was expanded to a munitions factory in 1696 when the Royal Laboratory was constructed for the purpose of manufacturing ammunition, fuses and gunpowder. The central parts of the Royal Laboratory, which we have preserved, are the earliest surviving buildings in the Arsenal today. There is much nostalgia about the Arsenal. There are over 3,000 people working here today, many of whom have worked here all their lives. Indeed, there may possibly be some here who were born here. The decision to close the Royal Ordnance Factory in March 1967 was a blow, not only to the employees, but also to the town itself, which after all did grow from the Arsenal. The subsequent sale of much of the land marked the end of an era. Fortunately, the architectural merit and historic value of some of the buildings contained in this, the western part, were recognized as worthy of preservation. And so it came about that this small part of the original hundreds of acres was retained for the Ministry of Defense. Most of the less desirable buildings have been removed, and modern ones have taken their place. Every effort is being made, and will continue to be made, to create an environment which will provide the facilities required to meet modern needs whilst retaining the links with the past. The Woolwich Master Plan for rebuilding the site made provision for the statue of the Duke of Wellington to be resited within the inner security fence, and this, as you see, has been finally accomplished. Other historical pieces from the Royal Arsenal have been incorporated within the surrounding wall to make a memorial. These are not all contemporary with the statue. We thought that the move afforded an opportunity to bring together such fine pieces of equipment and structure that remained with us. Now about the guns. The larger cannon are of the type used at the Battle of Waterloo. They are smoothbore brass six-pounders. The one on the left of the statue is dated 1850, the one on the right 1855. In both instances, I'm afraid, the carriages are not original. The small cannon are smoothbore bronze three-pounders. The one on the left is dated 1807, the one on the right 1813. All four of these cannons were made here at Woolwich. And now the frieze. The particularly fine 19th century cast ironwork incorporated in the wall originated from the buildings which until recently adjoined the pavilions of the Royal Laboratory. The upper frieze depicts cannon, cannon shot, royal ciphers, and reproduction of some ordnance parts. There are also some Congreve rockets. The lower frieze contains the initials of members of the Royal Laboratory Committee who were appointed by the Master General and the Board of Ordnance in 1852 to draw up a scheme for improving the efficiency of the Royal Laboratory. The small shield holding the initials RMG are those of Lord Raglan, the Master General of the day. The Chieftain tank and the light gun are there to show that we don't live in the past and to demonstrate our modern work. Now, the statue itself. This is by Thomas Milnes, who presented it to the Board of Ordnance in 1848. It was originally erected in the Tower of London to complement the Waterloo Barracks there. It was moved to Woolwich in 1863, where it stood for 111 years to the south of the Grand Stores. The His statue records the great Duke of Wellington as Master General of the Ordnance, a post he held between 1818 and 1827. It is the Duke of Wellington's association as Master General of the Ordnance which links him most closely with Woolwich and makes it so appropriate that the 8th Duke of Wellington has joined with General Sir John Gibbon, the 69th Master General of the Ordnance, to officiate at this ceremony today. We are also particularly pleased to see such a strong Royal Artillery participation in this ceremony. This is right and proper. The associations between the Royal Arsenal and the Royal Regiment have been strong indeed, and today's ceremony underlines that relationship. This occasion heralds the start of a new era in the history of the Royal Arsenal, marking as it does the final part of the modernization program carried out for us by the Property Services Agency of the Department of the Environment. It does provide us with the opportunity to shake off some of the sadness that has surrounded the Arsenal since the Royal Ordnance Factory closed. Old Woolwich Arsenal has a glorious history. Thank heavens this has not been lost. The best of it remains, and dare I say, the quality part. Long may it continue. Your Grace, will you now please inspect the King's troop before unveiling the plaque?
To the gates of Paris, which surrendered on July the 3rd. On the 15th of July, the Italian reviewed the remainder of his weekend. At that time, troops were marched aboard one of Her Majesty's warships and surrendered and sailed to Plymouth. Thus ended one of the most decisive campaigns in world history, certainly in the history of this country. The men who marched into Paris on July the 3rd left behind them a battlefield still laid out at that time, bearing the scars of the battle only 3 weeks before, and they left behind a great many of their comrades. Those of you who have visited the battlefield will know that the British or Allied front, to be more exact, was scarcely a mile wide. The French were lined up at the start of the battle across a shallow valley only about a mile away. On this relatively small area, over 200,000 men, and many of them not until the evening, were engaged in a battle which lasted for about 8 hours. It was a holocaust, quite frankly, one of the bloodiest battles because of the numbers involved in the small area that has probably ever taken place. Estimates vary, but probably something like between 50 and 70,000 men fell on that day. A very large number. There have always been two matters that surprised me in the course of that battle, and I'll say something about it because they're both connected with guns and the use of guns and use of artillery. During the great cavalry charge commanded by Ney in person, Marshal Ney, Chief of Staff to Napoleon, and at that moment in tactical command of the battle, there was no use, or so history records, of infantry or artillery. Mass cavalry against well-trained British squares were of no avail. I have often felt that had Napoleon brought up, and he's surprising he didn't because he's an artilleryman, if he had brought up his artillery, he might have made all the difference, of course, in the battle. They could have done great damage to British squares at close quarters. The second thing that has surprised me always is that in comparison, the great thing brought up his artillery to meet the onslaught in the French cavalry. And most of us, or many of us here today, know the well-known account of Merton's Bagley coming up at the gallop, much to the approval of the great Duke. And they unlimbered and fired at short range, about 100 yards, even less, with the mass wave of the cavalry coming over the brow. Their intervention was decisive. In the course of the onslaught on the square, the gunners removed one wheel, technical process of which I do not know, but presumably knocking out that pin, which I see there, and trundled the one wheel of the guns into the square, leaving the gun on the ground immobilized. It has always surprised me that the French made no attempt to put those guns out of action, which they were quite capable of doing by spiking them or some other means. That is the second thing that always has always surprised me. The army arrived in Paris, as I said, on July 3rd, and its commander-in-chief took up his duties as British ambassador. During those 3 next years, he took the decision, surprising to his contemporaries, and many of them were critical of it, to enter politics. And his first post was as Master General of the Ordnance with cabinet rank. I think it's rather pity the Master General Morden doesn't still have cabinet rank. Perhaps he might not be in such a mess as we are now. He remained as Master General for 9 years. But he always took an enormous interest in the place. And some years later, when there was a question of abolishing it, he intervened in the strongest possible terms. In 1848, while he was still alive, this statue was erected in the Duke Hyde in the Tower of London. The Duke, by that time, was an Earl of Statesman, greatly loved and greatly respected throughout the country. Everyone went to him for advice. The last year of his life, at the Great Exhibition, even Queen Victoria turned to him because of the trouble they were having with sparrows inside the crystal, what was the crystal palace, the Great Exhibition Hall, and said, "Pray, please, what do we do about the sparrows?" His answer was typical, short, and incisive. "Try sparrows, man." He died the following year, and today we are here to recognize the unveiling or the re-election of this statue here as Master General. He was, I am told, a great Master General. With his flair for organization, I believe he did much to improve the administration of the Royal Arsenal. This statue has had many homes, as you've heard. I would like to thank Master General of the Ordnance and Brigadier Maple for doing me the honour of inviting me to declare it, I can't say declare it open, but to unveil this flag on what I hope will be its last final home. It could certainly not have a fitting one or a more beautiful one. I will now proceed to unveil the flag.
Still on.
What?
Still on. Just in case, it's a little bit again.